Chandrika, she will talk on Advaita and recent day scenario. Friends, before inviting them to speak on their scheduled topic, it's my honor and privilege to speak a few words on their introduction on their academic pursuits. Professor S. Ponnirselvam, the first speaker in the first session. Professor Ponnirselvam is the former professor and head, Department of Philosophy, Madras University, Chennai. Major fields of his specialization include Advaita, philosophy of language, postmodernism, critical theory. Professor Ponnirselvam was a fellow in Indo-Sastri Konarian Institute in 2003. He was also invited to deliver a number of lectures in different Canadian universities. He was also the visiting professor at Concordia University in 2004. He was also nominated by ICPR for research work at Paris in 2006. He also visited Bangkok to participate 8th Asian Bioethics Conference in 2007. And he had been invited to many Indian and global universities to talk on different issues in philosophy that I do not want to reflect upon due to the paucity of time. Friends, Professor Ponnirselvam has many publications. I want to recite some of his major publication. And they are problem of meaning with reference to Wittgenstein and Wakanen, postmodernism and critical theory, conflicts of philosophy, history and religion, Indian philosophy, prospect and retrospect. Professor Ponnirselvam has also published hundreds number of research papers in different national and international journals. He was also the editor and co-editor of a number of journals on philosophy, religion, value, and culture. He was also a member of different philosophical forums. He was also the secretary of Indian Philosophical Congress. And he has been awarded with different citation from different universities and for institutions. And in the second session, we have with us Professor B. Chandrika. She will speak on Advaita and the present day scenario. Professor B. Chandrika was the retired professor and director of Sri Shankaracharya University of Sanskrit and International School for Sri Shankara Studies, Kalari, Kerala. She has 36 years of teaching in different government colleges and universities. Professor B. Chandrika had done her PhD on study of Atmabodha with Prakashika, commentary of Vishweshwar Pandita. Professor Chandrika worked as the Dean, Faculty of Indian Metaphysics, convener, International Complaint Committee. And Professor Chandrika also completed UGC project on Upanishad. And she guided many scholars in ICPR minor projects. She guided 8 PhD students, 14 MPhil scholars. And she had a number of papers published in different national and international journals. She has also organized different national and national seminars in Sanskrit. I do not want to reflect upon all the things because of the passage of time. I welcome both the senior teachers of philosophy to this webinar. And in the first, I also welcome our host and admini, Professor Pramod Kumar Das, and co-admini and moderator, Dr. K. Omnaran Rao, to this session. With this, I once again welcome all the teachers, scholars, and students of philosophy to this webinar. And with this, I want to call upon Professor Panirselvam to schedule, but to speak on the scheduled topic. Pranam sir.
Thank you very much, Professor Arya, for introducing me. At the outset, I am grateful to the organizers, the philosophy family, for inviting me to give a talk on Advaita and analysis. Of course, here I could see great people like my good friend, the Professor G.P. Das, Professor Pramod Kumar Das, Vasant Kumar Das, Sri Vyas Ji, Professor Krishnaya, Dr. Srinivasan, Professor Chandrika, Professor Om Narayan Rao, Ranjit Ghosh, and many others. I am happy to record that the effort taken by the philosophy family is something remarkable, for the main reason that they are able to organize a webinar during this COVID time, and we are able to meet each other through online and discuss some of the important philosophical problems. Also, I must record here that they are able to bring out a volume based on the talk given by the speaker. This is something which is very, very important, because their effort is something which we have to appreciate. So with this brief note, I would like to make a presentation. Actually, my paper or my talk is based on the contribution of the Oriya tradition in the context of Advaita Vedanta, because I have a very great regard for the Oriya tradition. This means their contribution to philosophy in general and Advaita in particular. At this juncture, I would like to remember the great contribution made by thinkers like late Professor Ganeshwar Mishra, whose contribution is something remarkable. And we have great thinkers like senior most professors like G.C. Nayak, Professor K.P. Mishra, whom I know very intimately, Professor P.K. Mahapatra, Vijayananda Kar, and my good friend G.P. Das, and many others. Of course, I am just mentioned only few of them, because the entire department, the Utkal Philosophy Department, contribution to analytical philosophy in the context of Advaita is something which I always cherish. And I must also record that it is Ganeshwar Mishra who made me to look at Indian philosophy, especially Advaita, from a new perspective. I should tell you the background in which I was fascinated by his writing. His book was presented to me by my teacher, Professor R. Balasubramanian. And while giving that book, he said, "Don't read this book." So I read that book, because we always violate the guidance given by our teachers, you know. So I started reading that. Why he wanted me to avoid reading is that he, being a traditional Advaita, he was not developed by Professor Ganeshan Mishra. But when I start reading that, I got a different understanding of Indian philosophy. And later, when I was with the professor, late Professor K. Chachidanamurthy, when he was a vice chairman of UGC, I met him once in his office. So he was asking me this question. Thesis on. I said I am working on Shankara and Wittgenstein for my PhD thesis. Then he said, you should read Ganeshan Mishra's writing. So these two incidents would clearly show that it was Ganeshan Mishra who first, as far as I know, made an attempt to understand Indian philosophy, especially in Shankara's Advaita Vedanta, from the analytical standpoint. And also here I must also record with gratitude the contribution of my good friend, Professor G.P. Das. G.P. Das' wonderful book on Vedanta Paribhasha is something which I used to refer for my students. And he has also made a new attempt in understanding Advaita Vedanta from the analytical standpoint. So what I'm trying to say is the contribution of the Utkal University in analytical philosophy is something remarkable. Now, I would like to examine this issue, that is the relation between Advaita and analysis, in this way. Now, how do we understand the word analysis? Ammerman, in this edited volume of the Classics of Analytic Philosophy, says, analysis is a way of grouping together heterogeneous philosophies interested in analyzing linguistic or conceptual units. This means the language analysis of the West as well as East have grown and developed independently of each other. In spite of this, we are able to see some similarities between East and West. Both the contemporary analytical philosophy and the classical Indian philosophy are interested in some of the problems like knowledge, the varieties of meaning, and the concept of reference, etc. And here, I must also mention the contribution made by B.K. Mathilal, who has written an excellent work on the analytical philosophy in comparative philosophy or comparative perspective. The analysis of knowledge in its various aspects has been a favorite subject for the Indian thinkers from the ancient time onwards. In Shankara's writings, especially in his commentary on the Brahma Sutra, we find analysis of language and problems connected with it. Advaita Vedanta of Shankara is generally considered to be the crowning achievement of the philosophical speculations of ancient India. I would like to see the relation between Advaita and analysis by offering some methods or models which are very much familiar. I would like to state here that there are some models that are important in understanding Indian philosophical discourse where the method of analysis is applied. For example, Professor Svijivin Bhattacharya has used the mathematical logic to understand Navya-Nyaya. Similarly, B.K. Mathilal has applied the analytical philosophy to understand Nyaya realism, and J.N. Mohanty has applied the Husserlian method for understanding Indian philosophical problems. And of course, Ganeshan Mishra's linguistic and the analytical trends to interpret Advaita and Professor R. Balasubramanian's phenomenological and analytical way of understanding Advaita Vedanta are some of the methods which we must take into account. The first method which I would like to discuss with you very briefly, of course, is Professor Ganeshwara Mishra's method. Professor Ganeshwara Mishra approaches Shankara's philosophy from the analytical standpoint of the Western tradition, and he applies the Western model to Indian philosophy, especially to Advaita Vedanta, and argues, this is very important, that linguistic analysis is the aim of Shankara. He maintains the view that according to Shankara, Shabda Pramana means a critique of the structure and function of language. He definitely has some insights. Shankara's doctrine of Adhyasa, for example, according to Mishra, preaches a philosophy of language and not an account of the illusory character of the world in which we live, move, and have our being. And he says in his very interesting article published in the Indian Philosophical Quarterly in 1975, with the title Shankara's Doctrine of Adhyasa, Difficulties of Propositional Symbolism, wherein he says, I quote him, "Metaphysics, even in the days of Shankara, was openly and outwardly concerned with linguistic and logical analysis. Analysis of logical concepts or mapping out the conceptual framework and nothing else," unquote. This beautiful quotation shows that how Professor Ganeshwara Mishra could understand Advaita purely from the analytical standpoint. His two important books, sir, are very useful in this direction: The Analytical Studies in Indian Philosophical Problems, and the second book, Advaita Conception of Philosophy, Its Method, Scope, and Limits. These two books, sir, throw enough light to approach Advaita from the analytical perspective. In this new approach, Professor Mishra tries to see Shankara's philosophy of language in the background of Western tradition. This model or this methodology tries to give enough arguments to prove that Indian tradition does not lack the analytical approach. The traditional Indian philosophers of the past were actually doing the same thing which the contemporary Western philosophers are at present doing in the name of philosophy. This is a statement of Professor Mishra. He further argues, this is what is available in this book, The Analytical Studies of Indian Philosophy, I quote, "Shankara's logic corroborates and confirms the findings of this philosophy of language. His theory of meaning and his theory of proposition show that all descriptive language is incomplete in the sense that identification propositions alone are self-complete in meaning," unquote. This one methodology, which is very important, and I would always recommend the students of philosophy to read these two important books of Professor Mishra if they want to know Indian philosophy or understand Indian philosophy from the analytical standpoint. Then another methodology which is very much available is Professor B.K. Mathilal's method, who has also given a new way of understanding of Advaita through analysis and a comparative method. In fact, I would call this method as comparative analytical method. His observations to Indian philosophy of language and analysis are seen in some of his important books like Logic, Language, and Reality, The Analytical Philosophy in a Comparative Perspective, edited with J.L. Shaw. And another important book, very, very important book, is The Word and the World. According to B.K. Mathilal, what we call philosophy of language in India has always formed a part of a classical philosopher's general epistemological inquiry, part of a Pramana Shastra, the theory of evidence for belief and knowledge. The question which he raises here is, how does a linguistic utterance through the communication of its meaning, impart the knowledge to the hearer. He classifies the issues discussed under Indian philosophy of language as follows. I quote him. This is available in The Word and the World. He says, analysis of sentences and words into significant components, the relationship between the word and meaning, classification of words according to semantic contribution, division of words with reference to the division of ontological categories are very much present in Indian philosophical tradition. All these have been repeatedly discussed by the philosophers in India over the centuries. So this method of B.K. Mathilal has certain advantages. What are the advantages? First of all, it has not reduced everything to analysis, and hence the fallacy of reductionism is avoided. Secondly, it allows us to think and apply the Western methodology to Indian philosophical problems, right? And ponder over the question why the very similar puzzles evoke different responses from different people. So this is the second model which I thought would be very helpful to understand the relation between the analysis and Advaita. And the third important method or methodology could be seen in the writings of Professor Ramakrishna Puligandla. He is from Andhra Pradesh, but later settled in US, a very well-known analytical thinker as well as a phenomenologist. He has used modern logic and analysis in order to understand Advaita Vedanta. He looks at Shankara's doctrine of Adhyasa from the analytical standpoint. His very important paper is An Analytical Interpretation of Shankara's Philosophy, wherein he argues that the proposition that reality is formless and nameless and non-dual is a necessary condition for the arising of the concept of Adhyasa. Where this condition is not fulfilled, the concept of Adhyasa cannot arise. By comparing Shankara with Kant, Immanuel Kant, he concludes that Shankara was not primarily concerned with metaphysics, right? Understood in the sense constructing abstract intellectual systems whose aim it is to describe through categories what a given thinker constitutes to be reality. Similarly, in another interesting paper, Consciousness and the World in Advaita Vedanta by Puligandla, he tries to show that the concept of anirvachaniya does not violate the laws of logic as scholars claim. It is argued by many that the Advaitins view that the world is neither real nor unreal violates the law of non-contradiction and the law of excluded middle. Puligandla, by using the technique of symbolic logic, especially uses the De Morgan's law, and argues or try to prove that there is no violation of laws of logic in the definition of anirvachaniya given by the Advaitins. So this is another method of Puligandla which has to be taken very seriously if you want to read Advaita and analysis. Then one more method I would like to suggest here, that is given by Professor G.C. Nayak. G.C. Nayak's very interesting book is The Philosophical Reflections, where there is one interesting paper that is Illumination Through Analysis, a study in Vedantic conception vis-a-vis the Madhyamika. This is the title of his paper, which is available in the book, The Philosophical Reflections by G.C. Nayak. This article deals with an important issue regarding the role of analysis in Advaita Vedanta. Generally, scholars argue that Advaitins are interested in liberation of the individual is concerned with the intuitive experience of Brahman. This means that illumination is possible through Brahma Anupava. But G.C. Nayak talks about illumination through analysis. This analysis is made on the basis of the understanding of the nature of Brahman and not by inference or by any other means. Different means of knowledge, though are important, they cannot help us in the realization of Brahman, and hence Shankara shows the limitations of the Pramanas. Perception and other means of knowledge cannot give us the immediate knowledge of the self. It is because the scope of such means of knowledge is limited to empirical knowledge. Now, let us see how Professor Jishu Naik has examined this. Jishu Naik argues that how the Vakyartha Vicharana, or analysis of meaning of statements, plays an important role in the methodology of Shankara. This means analysis of meaning is not something alien to Shankara or Indian philosophy, but the analysis which he speaks, that is Jishu Naik speaks, is different from that of ordinary one, because for Shankara, more mere analysis of statement is not important for the realization of Brahman. It means only analysis of statement dealing with the Mahavakya will lead us to Brahman. It is because of this main reason that ordinary sentences are secular and hence cannot help us in any way to the attainment of liberation. Ultimately, it is the understanding of the Mahavakyas which gives enlightenment. I quote Professor Jishu Naik. He says, it is not merely the understanding of the explicit meaning of any sentence that gives enlightenment. Without understanding the meaning of the Vedantic statements, one cannot realize the ultimate unity between Atman and Brahman. And it is known through, and he says, further he says, the knowledge of being eternally free comes from the Vedantic statements and not from anything else. So Vedantic statements, which occupy a different realm and status, will lead to enlightenment. This means that texts which deal with the identity alone can help us in realization. Freedom or illumination here means freeing oneself from bondage, and once this is attained, realization is possible. So these methodologies or these methods clearly show that in Indian philosophy, especially in Advaita, we have different methods of analysis. And in fact, I would say the method of analysis is seen in a broader perspective in Indian tradition. And in fact, Indian philosophers could go further in order to show how the supersensuous reality could be understood through analysis. And now I would like to show how Brahman and language is related. When we use language, the language is used in order to say something about the empirical things. For example, when a word table is used, it is used in order to understand the object which exists in front of me. I touch the table and I can understand it. But how do I understand the word Brahman? Here, the meaning of the term Brahman has to be understood from another perspective. For example, the Mimamsakas could say that when a word heaven is uttered, at first nobody knows the meaning of the word. We guess the meaning of the word from the context in which it occurs. Similarly, when we first hear the word Brahman, we assume it to have some meaning or other. We know that the word has got some meaning. The meaning of the word becomes clearer when we see the syntactical connection of the word with other familiar words in Vedic sentences. So etymology and grammar comes to our aid. This means Upanishadic texts like reality, knowledge, and infinity is Brahman. And this sentence has to be understood in this way. Similarly, the Brahma Sutra says, I quote, then therefore the desire to know Brahman. Here we cannot understand the meaning of the word Brahman unless we take it to mean that it is a real thing which is to be known because it is the highest end. So the word Brahman has to be understood from a different perspective. Perhaps keeping in his mind, it is argued by the Canadian philosopher H.G. Kovart that Indian philosophers have carefully avoided the reductionistic mistakes. What is that? One is whenever we understand language, we try to say that language is used at the phenomenal level. For example, when a word table is used, I can perceive the table. So language is always used in the phenomenal level. That's how the Western philosophy or the Western linguistic analysis operates. And there is also another way of understanding a word or a sentence, that is a metaphysical realm. Now, H.G. Kovart says that Indian philosophers have avoided this reductionist mistake. One is one can either reduce language to mere phenomenal level, or one can say it functions only at the metaphysical level. These two problems are avoided, and they use the same language in order to say something about the supersensuous reality. So there is an interlink that exists between Brahman and language. And Shankara, in all his commentaries, one can see how he is using the analytical tool. In fact, I would say that he says that Brahman can never be described, but it can only be shown. And that too, somehow approximately. At least two methods are suggested for this purpose. The first one is the method of Adhyarupa and Apavada, and the second is the method of Lakshana. For example, in the Bhagavad Gita, the commentary of Shankara goes like this: Brahman is not said to be Sat or Asat. Brahman cannot be described by the word is or by the word is not, for it is not the object of knowledge in the form of is or is not. An object of knowledge is known through the means of knowledge and is defined such and such. But Brahman cannot be described by any word, not even by the word Sat. For a word can denote a thing if that object is associated with a genus, that is a jati, or an act, that is kriya, or a quality, guna, or relation, sambandha. For example, cow and horse imply genera, cook and teacher imply acts, white and black imply qualities, wealthy and cattle owner imply possession. But Brahman belongs to no genus and cannot be denoted by such words as Sat. But being devoid of attributes, it possesses no qualities. If it were possessed of qualities, then it could be denoted by a word implying a quality. So that is the reason why Taittiriya Upanishad says, whence, that is away from Brahman, unable to approach Brahman, all words along with mind return. So since Brahman is beyond everything, it cannot be described by words. So words fail to describe the concept of Brahman. So here we can use the Adhyaropa and Apavada. In fact, that is a affirmation and subsequent negation. This Apavada, according to my teacher, Professor R.B., he says it is not negation, but it is a subsequent negation, that is immediate negation. For example, the text says, Brahman has no hands, legs, eyes, hands, faces, and ears on all sides. Encompassing all, it stands. And immediately this is rejected. So if Brahman is described as it moves, then immediately it is negated in the very next sentence. For example, you can take Isha Upanishad. It says, that moves, that does not move. This is far off, that is very near. That is inside all, and that is outside. So all this clearly show that there is a affirmation and immediate or subsequent negation. Adhyarupa and Apavada. And also, we know that the method of Lakshana is used, that is both Tadastha Lakshana and Swarupa Lakshana is used in order to define or in order to explain the nature of Brahman. And whenever we use a word, the word has to be understood in a negative sense. I would like to give a commentary of Shankara of Taittiriya Upanishads. He says, goes like this. The sentence, Satyam Jnanam Anantam Brahma, Brahman is truth, knowledge and infinite, is meant as a definition of Brahman. For these words beginning with Satya are meant to distinguish Brahman, which is substantive. And from the fact that Brahman is the thing intended to be known, it follows that Brahman is a substantive. So this means it is very clear from Shankara's commentary that only by using the Swarupa Lakshana and Tadastha Lakshana, we can explain the nature of Brahman to some extent only. And we must also use another method in order to understand the analytical content or the analytical approach of Shankara. For it, normally we say that sentences are classified into two categories. One is sentences which are having a relation or otherwise known as samsarga avagahi vakya, and those sentences which do not signify the relation, that is non-relational sentences, otherwise known as samsarga na avagahi vakya, or otherwise known as the agandarthaka. Here you can see the beautiful analysis which is very much available in Indian tradition. A sentence like rose is red comes under the category of samsarga avagahi, because we say that the character of a rose is red in color. So there is a relation that is involved, substantive adjective relation. But in the case of Mahavakyas like that thou art, I am Brahman, it has to be used, it has to be known from samsarga na avagahi or non-relational context. So which means non-relational sentences do not involve, right, the relation. This sometimes is related to the identity statements. For example, Frege's well-known example, like the morning star is the evening star. Of course, I am not elaborating it further. How much time I have, Professor Daj? Can I take another 10 minutes?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Another 10 minutes I'll take. According to Advaita, the Brahmana part of the Veda is divided into the Vidhi Vakyas, Arthavada and Vedanta Vakyas. Now the Arthavakyas are further divided into three kinds, the Gunavada, Anuvada and Bhutarthavada. A Gunavada is a sentence which contradicts what is known from the other Pramana. For example, the sentence, the sacrificial post is the sun, is a Gunavada. And Anuvada is something already known through other Pramanas. For example, we can say fire is the antidote for cold. A Bhutarthavada states something which is neither contradicted nor confirmed by the other Pramana. Example, Indra raised his weapon against Vritra. The Mimamsakas argue that the purport of the Vedas lies in action. So the sentences of the Vedas thus are classified into two groups, the Vidhi Vakyas and the informative and existent object, that is Siddhartha Bodhaka Vakyas. While the sentence of the former group, that is Vidivakya, enjoin some action to be performed, those of the latter group convey the knowledge of the objects already exist. The Prabhakaras maintain that the only injunctive sentences of the Veda have validity, and informative sentences which occur in the Veda, such as Satyam Jnanam Anantam Brahma, which describe the nature of Brahman, are not valid on their own, since they are not injunctive. But these texts form a part of Veda and hence cannot be ignored either. So they have to be accommodated by making them subsidiary to the injunctive words, which are principle. So the Arthavadas, in order to be valid, must be construed as a subsidiary to the injunctive text, that is vidisesha. Now a secular sentence like there are fruits in the trees on the other side of the bank, which is existential, has to depend on another pramana or the means of valid knowledge for which it conveys, and hence has no validity. If the sentence is injunctive, what it enjoins cannot be within the range of another pramana, and hence it will have independent validity. Applying the same principle to the Shruti texts which are examined, the Mimamsakas argue that they should be treated as injunctive, as construed with injunctive texts for preserving their independent validity. Thus, for the Mimamsakas, all the Arthavadas are not authoritative in themselves, and they serve as auxiliaries to injunctive sentences, that is Vidivakyas. Now, here the Advaitins raise some objection. This is not acceptable to the Advaitins for two reasons. One, they say, it should be noted that dependence on another pramana is not due to a sentence being existential, because there is such dependence even in the injunctive sentence like bring the cow. The reason for dependence on another pramana is elsewhere. A sentence uttered by a human being will have to depend on another pramana for what it conveys of whether it is existential or injunctive. So only sentences of a human origin have this dependent nature. In the case of Shruti texts like that Dadavar, there are no difficulty since they are apurushaya. So if the Mimamsakas say that Arthavadas do not have any independent validity, because according to them they are dependent on another pramana, and hence should be treated as subsidiary to injunctive texts, then the injunctive sentences, injunctive texts, that is the Vidivakyas, can also be rejected on the same basis. And the second reason which the Advaitins give runs as follows: knowledge has a intrinsic validity, both in respect of origin and ascertainment. First of all, the very conditions under which it arises account for its validity. Secondly, even it arises, it is believed to be valid without requiring verification by some other knowledge. It means all knowledge, it presumably valid whenever to be the pramana when it arises. If so, then the Mimamsaka's contention that all informative sentences which occur in the Vedas are not valid on their own, and hence must be construed as a subsidiary to injunctive text, is not correct. This is the argument given by the Advaitins. So all sentences are meaningful and valid by themselves and need not be construed to other sentences. Thus, the Advaitins argue that all the Vedanta Vakyas are purposeful, because the identity of Brahman and the individual self is realized from them. So these sentences are not subsidiaries to any ritualistic action as conceived by the Mimamsaka. So when the identity is realized, then there is no necessity for us to practice the ritualistic actions. Then the last part I would like to discuss with you, how one can understand the Vedanta Vakyas from the standpoint of analysis. So, or what I would like to call the analytical understanding of the Vedanta Vakyas. Now, the Vedanta Vakyas are classified into those sentences which are concerned with ascertainment of the nature of the Supreme Self, and two, those sentences which are concerned with teaching the identity of the Supreme Self with the individual self. So the first kind of sentences are once again divided into the essential, that is Swarupa, non-relational definitions of Brahman, and accidental or Tatastha definition of Brahman based on the false attribution. So The second kind of sentences are further divided into four types. That is, that declaring thou to be identical with Brahman, two, that declaring I to be Brahman, three, that which proclaims the identity of self with Brahman, and four, that which declares that consciousness is Brahman. So this is the methodology which is very much available in Advaita Vedanta. And finally, I would like to state here, the Mahavakyas, the significance of the Mahavakyas is something really great, because the Mahavakyas actually come under the category of grammatical coordinate relation. This is, here we see a beautiful method of analysis practiced by Shankara and his followers. So the Mahavakyas come under the category of the grammatical coordination, or what we call Samanadhikaranya. What does this mean? It speaks about the grammatical coordination or grammatical coordinate relation that exists between words. It is the application of one thing of several words having the same case for the application of each, which there is a different reason. In the Samanadhikaranya, there are four ways of understanding, it is said. One, the first of the Samanadhikaranya, in Samanadhikaranya, the words used are in the same case. Secondly, they are not synonyms. They refer to one and the same reality. And finally, there is a reason for using each word, like the morning star is the evening star. Because the word morning star has a particular meaning and particular usage or particular reference, similarly the evening star. So there are four types of Samanadhikaranya. First one is the Badayam Samanadhikaranya. Second is Adhyasa Samanadhikaranya. Vishesha Visheshana Samanadhikaranya. And finally, Aikya Samanadhikaranya. Now, which one is useful to understand the Vedanta Vakyas or the Mahavakyas? Now, the first one, let us very briefly analyze one by one. Badayam Samanadhikaranya. This is of two kinds. One is the Mukhya Samanadhikaranya, and the second is Badayam Samanadhikaranya. In Mukhya Samanadhikaranya, the objects denoted by the words of a sentence will have equal ontological status, will be identical in nature, and will not be really different from each other. For example, when we say that the Katakasha Mahakasha Iva, that means the pot eater is but the great eater. The words Ghatakasha and Mahakasha are in Mukhya Samanadhikaranya. This means the pot enclosed eater and the other outside it have the same ontological status. That is, once the pot is broken, then they have the same ontological status. That is, both are empirically real. Also, both of them have the same nature and are not different from each other. If the words of a sentence which have the same case ending denote objects which have different ontological status, and if they purport to convey only one idea, then they are in Badayam Samanadhikaranya. I said there are two kinds of Samanadhikaranya. One is Mukhya, which I explained just now, and this is Badayam Samanadhikaranya. For example, when we say, I am Stanu Purusha, which means the post is a man. The post is a man. The objects denoted by the word Stanu and Purusha have different ontological status. You see the difference. In the first one, the Katakasha and pot eater and the ether outside have the same case ending, but here it is not the case. The post, because the post and the human man are having two different ontological status. Since what it is really is a man and not a post, man is empirically real, where post is apparently real. A person, due to distance and other factors, first of all perceives a man as a post, but subsequently corrects the mistake when he knows that the object seen by him is not a post but a man, and then he enters the sentence. The post is a man. So it is absurd to say that on the basis of superficial reading of the sentence that he identifies the post with that of the man. What he intends to convey by the sentence is that the object which he cognizes as a post is indeed a man. Hence, the subsequent cognition of the object as a man sublates the earlier cognition of it as a post, and it does not take place without concealing the earlier cognition, which is erroneous. So the object referred to by the same sentence is only one. The sentence achieves its objective through the sublation of one cognition by the other cognition. Now the second important samanadhikaranya is adhyasa samanadhikaranya. This is a grammatical coordination involving error, and it is of two kinds. Once again, doshakritam samanadhikaranya and adoshakritam samanadhikaranya. In the first one, that is in the doshakritam, adoshakritam, a rope is mistaken as a snake. Due to the absence of light, one makes a mistake. And similarly, it is given, the Shankara gives example in the Upanishads, that from the Upanishads we can understand this. The earth is verily the rick, the fire, the salmon. Here, rick should be viewed as the earth and salmon as fire for the purpose of meditation on the authority of scriptures. So unlike the rope snake example, right, where a person not knowing the object in front of rope cognizes it as a snake, here, the mediator knows the rig as what it is, nevertheless, cognizes it as earth, and not because of ignorance, but because of a spiritual injunction. So, in the case of dosha kridam, it is adhyasa caused by ignorance, and in the case of adosha kridam, the adhyasa is deliberately practiced due to scriptural injunction. Now it is said these both cannot be used to interpret the Mahavakya because they do not allow any kind of superimposition in them. Then the third one is Visheshana Vishesha Samanadhikaranya. This is a very beautiful relation wherein we talk about the substantive adjective relation or substantive attributes relation. Example is Neelam Utpalam. The word Neelam Utpalam contains two words. Neelam and Utpalam convey different meanings. That is, the first one signifies the color characterized by the quality of blueness, that is Neelatva, while the latter a sentence possessing the property of lotusness, so that is Utpalatva. So this Vishesha Visheshana Samanadhikaranya cannot be used in order to understand the Mahavakya. This Samanadhikaranya cannot be used to interpret Mahavakya like Tattvamasi, because the words Tat and Tvam do not involve any Vishesha Visheshana relation. Then finally we come to the Aikya Samanadhikaranya, wherein we see a coordinate relation which involves the identity. The statement "this is that Devadatta" refers to the identity, that is Aikya, of the individual in spite of the differences in respect of a time and space. Similarly, the Mahavakya Tattvamasi speaks about the identity of the individual self with the Supreme Self. So it is clear, I'm concluding. So it is very clear from this brief discussion, I hope it is clear, that Advaita has the analytical approach with a special distinction. For the Advaitins, language has two dimensions. Though language is analyzed for the sake of explaining the empirical facts or the empirical reality and the experiences, language is used in order to say something about the nature of Brahman directly. It is true that language has its own limitation and cannot communicate the nature of Brahman. But it is only through the language at least something can be said about Brahman. Professor K. Chachananda Murthy very beautifully writes, when no description is possible of Brahman, the task of the Vedanta is to teach about it. And so logically speaking, it is not possible at all. So the Vedanta emphasizes the mystery of Brahman, which eludes all objective language. Yet it can be dealt only in this way if Brahman has to be talked about intelligibly, unquote. So this aspect of Indian philosophy is defined by thinkers like Professor A.G. Coward as the creativity in the method of analysis. I would like to quote Professor Coward. He says, the ability of language to deal with the ordinary human being and yet at the same time to be metaphysically grounded is evidence in the distinctive Indian notion of creativity. Indian approach shows itself to be more encompassing and insightful than the bifurcated and too narrow view of many of the Western schools, unquote. Similarly, J.G. Arapura, another important Indian philosopher who settled in Canada, while commenting on the nature of mystery of language, says that the tradition of Advaita Vedanta, what language was plugged into was consciousness per se, rather than understanding of man. He says, unquote, I quote, language is the means by which we can plunge into depth of our own consciousness, unquote. So with this, I would like to conclude my brief talk. And I am very grateful to scholars who could listen to me, and especially I'm grateful to Professor G.P. Das, who is a well-known scholar in Advaita as well as analytical philosophy. So I take this opportunity to thank the philosophy family for a wonderful opportunity. Thank you very much, friends.
Thank you, Professor Panchalivam. It was a great talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay, thanks so much, sir, for your very illuminating and thought-provoking talk on the Advaita through analysis. You have emphasized on Professor Ganesh Mishra's logical linguistic analysis in order to understand the Advaita Vedanta and other Indian philosophical problems. Sir, you have also reflected on the analytical method used by the Professor Ramakrishna, Professor G.C. Naik, and Professor Ganesh Prasad Das, and many other Indian thinkers and schools to understand Advaita Vedanta and other Indian philosophical problems. I do not want to reflect upon all the things that you have spoken today, and the discussion of your paper will be made after the talk of Professor B. Chandrika. Now we have to move to Professor B. Chandrika. I request and call upon Professor B. Chandrika to speak on Advaita and the present scenario. Over to Professor B. Chandrika, madam.
Yes, Professor Panneerselvam sir and Professor Chandrika madam for their very nice lectures. At first, I would like to thank Professor Panneerselvam sir for his very technical, thought-provoking and forward-looking presentation. In a sense, he has tried to apply the logical method, logical analytic method to understand Advaita Vedanta, and he sees late Professor Ganesh Mishra as a trendsetter in applying the analytic philosophy. Rather, he sees analytic philosophy very much there in the understanding of Shankara's philosophy. Because when, as I could know, I don't know how much I'm right, when he was in the West, he said that Indian philosophy was said that Indian philosophy is speculative. So in order to refute that, he said no. As far as the logical foundation in Advaita is concerned, it is very strong. There is no speculative element. It is very strong, and there is the analytic trend is very much contained in the Advaitic trend. So that's how Professor Panneerselvam has tried to bring out that point and making a reference to other professors, say Professor R.K. Puligentla and Mathilal, Professor Dishi Naik, Professor Ganesh Prasad Das sir, who is also there with us. So they have made enough contributions to apply the analytic train in understanding of Advaita. So very much thankful to you, sir. Actually, we have forgotten this and you have reminded us again so that we can have more and more research on this and to keep this trend alive in Odisha, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for your paper, sir. I also thank Professor Chandrika Madam for seeing the Advaita in the present day scenario. And she sees, despite various distinctions, differentiations, she feels that it is Advaita alone that can build, bring in a thread of unity among all. They can see unity, a sort of unity in one and all, and it is the solution that Advaita can offer. So I thank both the professors. Now I request the distinguished participants to comment on or to make observations or have the queries on both the presentations. Well, I see Professor. Ganesh sir is well. I request Professor Ranjit Ghosh sir. Well, he's there with us. At first, I would like to call Professor Ranjit Ghosh sir if he has anything to say, any observation to make, because I don't see any question in the chat box. Or anybody who wants to make any observation if he has any question on the subject, they are welcome. Well, Ranjit Ghosh sir has put on his microphone. Well, welcome, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Rao. Question is coming to my mind. If the spirit of Vedanta is metaphysical and axiological, then is it really necessary to have the language analysis, which is an epistemological one, in the field of Vedanta? Because you see, the Vedanta is to be understood as a part of the Prasthanatrayi, and in all these three Upanishads, Bhagavad Gita and Vedanta together, we get all the valuational and metaphysical issues. And therefore, if we try to analyze these concepts, well, Professor Panisilvam has referred to the galaxies of the analytic thinkers, some of whom are my teachers, and also we participated in different seminars on different occasions. But when Professor Mathilal came in one of the seminar of Professor Dayakrishna in Jaipur, they were discussing, it is 40 years back, so I was Dayaji wrote an article that Vedanta, does it mean anything? So at all, does it mean anything at all? So the thing is, the transcendental aspect and the valuational and metaphysical aspects are very much important. And in this regard, I would rather say that Professor Chandrika has referred to these aspects, that how Vedanta can shape our life, how the shape of things to come with the help of Vedanta. So, sir, if you have anything to enlighten us, please say. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Rajesh Ghosh, for your very nice observation. Now, let me try to answer you. Now, no doubt, Vedanta or any system of philosophy in India talk about the axiological and the metaphysical truths. No doubt about that. But at the same time, there is also the need or necessity to see the Indian philosophical tradition, especially Advaita, from other aspects also. Now, this was the need of the hour. In fact, Professor Ganeshan Mishra, after his training from the foreign universities, he thought that there is something new in this Western methodology. So he has tried to see Advaita or any system of thought from a new perspective. Now this perspective is very much essential for various reasons. One reason which I would like to give here is that the contemporary Indian philosophy, I mean the contemporary Indian philosophers have been severely criticized that Indian philosophy, especially the contemporary Indian philosophy, lacks any new methodology, and there was a lot of criticisms that they were nothing to offer, something new and all that one. So there was a need of the hour for our philosophers to show that ancient, this one way of understanding contemporary Indian philosophy, or applying the Western tools that are very much available, and try to apply our ancient system and try to show that our systems, we have the methodology of the Western thinkers like Wittgenstein or Husserl or phenomenology. Now, the question you may ask is question, why we should use Western methodology or Western understanding? Now, I feel this is very much essential, as Professor Mohanty would say, that the Indian philosophers must read Western philosophy and also vice versa. See, this means in order to enrich our own tradition, right, some methodologies from the West we can borrow and apply. That's why we are able to show that the method of analysis is not something new to us. The phenomenology, the so-called phenomenological method established by Brentano, Husserl and Heidegger and others are also very much could be seen in the context of Vedanta. And also the hermeneutical method, because in the 20th century, as you know, that these are the three important methods which are very much familiar and which are very dominating in the West. So this is a high time for us to go back to our tradition and see how our ancient systems also had these methodologies. So it means that there are different ways of looking at Indian philosophy. The metaphysical truth is something very important, no doubt. But here is a method which also can equate us with the Western tradition. This is one reason why I think that this methodology like the analysis or phenomenological understanding or hermeneutical are very much essential to apply that. And moreover, I would say that, but I would like to see the whole thing from a different perspective. I feel I am fully... In support of Ganesha Mishraji, because I feel that Shankara has made an attempt to show that it is not mere metaphysics, or it is not something very much related to metaphysics only, but it has got a linguistic analysis. Now, if you read this book, I humbly request you to go through these two books of Ganesha Mishra, which will change your perspective. That's why I always say that the Oriya tradition has contributed something novel. When first time, I'll take 2 or 3 minutes to explain to you, because when I first attended a conference in Utkal University, when I was a student of Christian College, I was amazed the way in which philosophers have been analyzing. Professor Ganesha Mishra, I could not see. But I saw K.P. Mishra and many others, G.G. Nayakji and others. It's a very beautiful way of understanding. I never thought that Indian philosophy could be seen from this perspective. This is something very amazing. It's something new. So why can't we try this method? And take Professor G.P. Das method in Vedanta Paribhasha. This is, in fact, for a very long time, I was using his book. And I was teaching this to some of our students. And somehow I lost the book. I don't know whether he has got some copy, or I would like to buy a copy, because these methods are, there are different ways of looking at Indian philosophy. What I'm humbly pointing out here is that don't subscribe to one method of doing Indian philosophy. Why do you think that metaphysics is the only way or axiological way of doing Indian philosophy? Right, there are other perspectives. Why can't you look at that? That will broaden your vision of Indian philosophy. That's why I am fond of These methods, whether it is Puligandla or G. Mathilal or Mohanty, all these methods are something remarkable. So this is what
congratulations. I Panneer Selvam sir, congratulations for your beautiful answer. Very nice answer you have given. I am asking one question to Professor Chandrika madam. In this connection, madam, congratulations for your beautiful talk. I am asking one question, share something. What are the important quotes we find in the Upanishad for the promotion of world peace? Tell me some important quotations or sentences which contribute for individual peace and world peace. Share something about some important sentences relating with world peace in Upanishads. Share something, madam.
Thank you, sir. I have already shared the certain things.
Tell me some important quotations, very, very powerful sentences, just like a Mahavakyas. Know yourself, die yourself, understanding about yourself is understanding the world. Like this, any important quotations or sentences you found in Upanishads, any Upanishad relating with individual transformation, individual peace or world peace. Say some important powerful sentences in Upanishads.
यत्र तोसि सर्वम् आत्मैव अभूत् तत्केन कं पश्येत् केन कं विजानीयात् तत्र कमोहः कशोकः एकत्वम् अनुपश्यतः सर्वे सन्तु सुखिनः इट् इस् नाट् फ्रम् उपनिषत्स् इट् इस् ओन्लि फ्रम् महाभारत तत्र कमोहः देयर् आर् सो मेनि यत्र यत्र तु यत्र सर्वम् एकनीडम् we can say so many things, so many quotations.
Not necessary, madam.
Anyway, thank you, madam.
Not necessary to post the quotes and important sentences.
Thank you, it is not necessary. Thank you, madam, for your nice. Professor. Also, thank you. Nice meeting. You have given very nicely. We enjoyed your program. I am appreciating the presiding professor also, Panneer Selvam also. Thank you very much. So we enjoyed your beautiful presence and talks. Thank you.
Thank you, madam.
Professor Panneer Selvam, sir, as he says, the so-called, let's say, the modern trends that we see in the Western world that are already there and we should search in Indian philosophical tradition. So that's the great message that we have from him. Thank you very much, sir. We need to. But the things that are being done, say, made the phenomenology, made the trend of analysis or existentialism. It is already contained in the Indian text, and we have to go through and we have to find them, and we have to prove that these things, the trends that are suggested to be new, that are already there in the Indian tradition and Indian philosophy. Thank you so much, sir, for setting the path and showing us the way. Thank you so much, sir. Well, we have with us Professor. Ganesh sir was there and he's probably some network issue. Well, I request our admin, Professor Pramod Kumar Das, to reflect on the talks, both the talks. Professor Pramod Kumar Das, our admin and host, I request him. Srinivasan sir wants to say something.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask one small question.
Welcome, sir.
Though I am just standing like a lamb in front of a lion and a lioness.
You.
I'm not able to question them because they are all highly, qualified intellectuals, and I am not competent enough to ask them questions. It is only a clarification. It's a clarification that both of them can answer, but otherwise, Professor Chandrika Madam can also answer. How is it that among all the individuals of this world, because you are speaking about the social harmony through scriptures and Upanishads, right?
Yes.
Mm. Of all the individuals of this world, only some rare ones have such a desire and others do not. What is the reason for this? Even within our own family, we don't find that kind of harmony. What is the reason for this?
Answer is there in my speech itself, sir. It might be our prior births and then benefit. That means it may be caused by our prior births emotions or something like that.
You mean the meritorious deeds of the fast.
Yeah.
I am wondering. Anyway. Thank you very much, sir. For your nice presentation, please.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, Professor Panicharlom, sir, I have nothing to answer in front of a great lion who gave us a beautiful picture about the Advaita Vedanta philosophy. So I am just, because I am focusing my attention only on Sankhya and Yoga philosophy, so I know about the Mahavakya said, Brahma Satyam Jagan Mitya Jivo Brahma Ivanapara. That's all in Advaita philosophy, but not otherwise. I am here to learn. I am only a novice in this field anyway. Thank you very much for your comprehensive coverage of the philosophical.
Thank you, Srinivasan, sir.
Now, well, I request.
Dr. Rao, one
yes, sir. Welcome, sir.
On another occasion, few days back, Professor Panirsilvam, I have asked this question that Brahmavid Brahmaiva Bhavati. So this Iva is metaphysical or epistemological? So, sir, at that time you told me that it is metaphysical. Now, on the whole, what I feel that the primacy of the metaphysical and axiological cannot override this epistemological and analytic issues. The Professor Mishra and they were all, I am also a pass out of Utkal University. I am coming out of that tradition. But the analysis at the end. So, what Vedanta should suggest, it is a metaphysics or axiology rather than an epistemology and analysis. This is my personal view, of course. Somebody may differ. So, on that occasion, you told me that Eva is metaphysical. That it came to my mind. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Ranjitji. Of course, in our previous discussion, I said Eva is metaphysical. Now, you see, I want to retain the both metaphysical and the epistemological. Now, I would say the entire discourse on the Indian philosophical tradition support both metaphysical and epistemology. Of course, the main purpose of Indian philosophical tradition is to speak about the metaphysical truths. No doubt about that. I don't question that. But you should also remember the fact that in order to claim the metaphysical truths, our Indian philosophical tradition use the pramanas, epistemology. That cannot be neglected. Without epistemology, metaphysics will collapse. See, I want to quote a Western thinker you might be knowing, H.G. Walsh, who wrote a book, Metaphysics, wherein he said, there is nothing wrong in talking about metaphysics. If philosophers are not going to talk about metaphysics, what else they are going to do? But, he says, it all depends on whether you are having a good metaphysics or bad metaphysics. What does he mean by this? He says, a good metaphysician is one who uses a proper argument in support of his metaphysical claim. Whereas a bad metaphysician cannot offer good arguments for his metaphysical claim. But in Indian tradition, both metaphysics and epistemology are important. Our purpose is to talk about metaphysical truths because we are talking about the supersensuous reality. The concept Eva actually talks about the metaphysical realm only. The entire discourse is like that. But I am giving you, by following the footpath of great thinker like Ganesha Mishra, there is also another way of looking at Indian philosophy. The same Vedanta, you can see from this perspective. Then what is the advantage? If you look at Advaita from the analytical tradition, something new is emerging. Why can't we take it? And further, I want to add this point also. Some may not agree with me. Now, if we read any textbook on Indian philosophy, all of them have stopped with Madhva. They don't go beyond that. As though philosophy has ended with the Madhva. It is not. But why? Because no, we have been all the time talking about the metaphysical truths or the metaphysical claims. But there are epistemological literature very much available in the Indian philosophical tradition. For example,
she also has Khandana Khandana Kar. You take a beautiful analysis given by Gangesa. So all these are not given proper importance. They have been neglected. Why? Because metaphysics has become a dominating feature. I am not saying that it is wrong, but there are also other areas which we have to probe into. Something new will emerge. I give one example. I always give this example. When 1963, when Gettier, you must be knowing, Edmund Gettier, when he wrote a 3-page article, his knowledge, true belief, his true belief knowledge, that is a question he raises. Now that 2.5-page article, not even 3-page, that could make a revolution in contemporary epistemology. But if you read Gangesa, you see similar problems are raised and has been answered. Answered by Gangesa, but in the West, still they are searching. Still they are not able to solve the problem. So there is also another way of looking at Indian philosophy. Please try to understand that, you know, Indian philosophy as a whole has to be read in the sense that, no, don't, I mean, this is my personal view, don't concentrate simply on metaphysical tools. They are very important, but see the logical or the analytical skill, which is very much present. The same method I would also apply to the phenomenology. Hermeneutics, for example, when it came as a very beautiful movement in the West in the 19th and 20th century, everybody appreciated. But ask those people to come to Indian side and look at our acharyas, great acharyas like Shankara, Ramanujan, Madhva, who are interpreted, who gave their commentaries to this Prasthanatraya. So this is not, this has been neglected. So I want to discuss with you, I wanted to show that the analysis is not something purely the property of the West. So analysis is not alien to Indian philosophy. That is my basic aim in claiming that there is also another way of looking at Indian philosophy. Not that I am claiming that my method is something supreme, but I am just inviting your kind attention that look at Indian philosophy from this perspective so that something new is emerging. This is the influence I got from these great thinkers like Ganeshan Mishra. Now, you see one thing, traditional Advaitins may not accept that. That's why I said in the beginning, when my teacher gave the book to me, he said, don't read it, because he thought I would be influenced by it. But I was very much influenced by it. Till now, I don't find any other book book of Ganeshan Mishra, which, you know, it will give you a new way of understanding Advaita or Indian philosophy in general. That is why I am applying this method.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Selvam. I do follow and I strongly affirm your view, and because even in unfurling Brahman, the technique that we adopt, neti neti, not this, not this, actually it is logical. It is actually based on the linguistic analysis.
Correct.
So we use this, but we forget that the method of analysis has been, we neglect that. What is this method? This is purely an analytical method. It is a logical, logical linguistic analytic method. So very much there, sir. And we need to do research on this area. And I think we should follow your footprints and go ahead with this culture. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. So now I request our admin, Professor Pramod Kumar Das, to make his own observations. Well, sir, are you...
Namaskar.
Yes, sir. Welcome, sir.
Am I audible, sir?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. So, both the talks were beautiful and wonderful. The job of a philosophy, each philosophical analysis, on the one hand, and the other hand is realization of the truth. In Indian culture, we emphasize on the second criterion, that is the realization of truths. And another job of philosophy is philosophical analysis. Because analysis is the method, if we do not, analysis is the job of philosophy. The first speaker emphasized upon the philosophical, the aspect of philosophical analysis in order to defend philosophy as philosophical analysis. This is an attempt, this is an analytical attempt, epistemological attempt, an empirical attempt also to understand the metaphysics. How metaphysics, when metaphysics is challenged in Western land, it is an attempt to understand and to explain metaphysics through an empirical tool that is language. Because language is man-made. Language is man-made. It is a human tool. It is a convention. It has its own grammar. The grammar is conventional. We only human beings understand language. Language is not the nature. Language is human. So it is a human tool. In that sense, it is an empirical tool. It is an epistemological tool. And through that tool, we are trying to understand the metaphysics. The second speaker tried to explain the opposite. She applied metaphysics in empirical living. If one is cultured with Advaita, if one is groomed with a harmony, sense of harmony, if one has wisdom of unity in diversity, he or she or that man can live a perfect life in the so much diversified situations. That means we can live with unity through different types of diversities. The second approach was that. My submission is, yes, as Professor Sir said that this is only perspective, linguistic perspective to understand that metaphysics. But Advaita, even we should not restrict Advaita as metaphysical only. So in that sense, linguistic perspective is very much necessary to discuss. But this is an human attempt for human understanding. But Brahman is Brahman, whether human beings are able to understand it or fail to understand it. Brahman is Brahman. Nature is nature. Sun is sun. Whether sun is understood or misunderstood, sun is sun. Ruta is ruta. Dharma is dharma. Whether it is understood or not understood. That aspect is missing in linguistic analysis. Linguistic analysis is only meant for understanding something. That something may be a stone, that something may be water, that something may be Brahman. It is only an attempt to understand those who do not understand. But realization of truth is something different. This is Atma-jnana. This is Atma. I am not a knower. So far as linguistic analysis is concerned, so far as epistemology is concerned, my identification is that, my identity is that, I am a knower. But so far as when I am saying Aham Brahmasmi, this is my realization. Here I am not the knower. Here the knower is identified with the known. Here knowledge, known and knower are all integrally identified to each other. They are integral to each other. They are one. This is a matter of realization, which comes beyond the sphere of human intellection, human intelligence. So man and Brahman, if they are two parties, Brahman will be understood and man will understand, there cannot be a bridge unless we have realization. This gap can be negotiated only through realization. It cannot be negotiated by the tools which is our own creation. We have created the tool, and we are trying to play with that tool. Therefore, if we shall take linguistic analysis in the proper sense, every language has its own connotation. As Wittgenstein said, Professor Saab has done his research in both Shankara and Wittgenstein. Wittgenstein has said that language becomes meaningful when it is proper played. That is a game. We have to play with language. That means we have to use language in the appropriate situations, and by that the meaning of a language will be decided. That means the language of religion, language of science, language of other spheres, they are differently used to stand for different types of sciences, different fields of our inquiry or knowledge. Therefore, the language of a laboratory is not equal with the language of a great seer who is doing meditation under a tree, who has a realization of the truth, who has realized the relative truths. For a common man, I see that this is truth. But for a great seer, the same thing appears to be false. How can we negotiate this gap? It is a matter of realization. The same world appears to me illusory. The same world appears to an ordinary man as very much real. The perspective also is an illusion. But it is a good perspective. This is a defense against the claims that we Indian philosophers or our Indian philosophy lacks this technology, this methodology of linguistic analysis. So in that way, we defended Indian philosophy, that Indian philosophy also discusses linguistic analysis. There are so many systems who have emphasized on linguistic analysis, on grammar. That is available in our literature. That is well understood. But Westerners are not our competitors. They are not our competitors. We are not going to compete with anybody. My realization is my realization. There is nobody who will compete with my realization because it is very much personal to me. My wisdom is my wisdom. The wisdom of a seer is the wisdom of that person. It cannot be met by university wisdom. It cannot be met by webinars, seminars, discussions, linguistic analysis. It can be realized in silence, in proper realization. So this is another sphere of discussion. Therefore, language has its own connotation means when we are discussing the language of metaphysics, that should not be confused with the language of empirical world. Then it will be a category mistake. The grammar of the empirical language, or when we are discussing about the empirical world and the way we are describing it through a particular code of language, that language is different. But when we are discussing about something which is indescribable, which cannot be thought of, achintya, abhyakta, anirvachaniya, where language cannot meet, that language is something different. That language is called Mahavakya. Aham Brahmasmi, Tattvamasi, Sarva Khaluidam Brahman. That is realization. That cannot be divided into subject predicate dichotomy. But that is a laboratory. Suppose we shall bring Brahman to the scientific laboratory, then we can deal with the human tool of language. Otherwise, we can't discuss. But in that linguistic laboratory, we can never have the realization of oneness, that I am not the knower. There is no external world outside me. Everything is one. This is a matter of realization. This may be challenged by Westerners because they don't have that realization. they are not Indian, therefore they can't have. So they are not our competitors. But this is a good defense that in our shop, this commodity is available. We also deal with linguistic analysis. The second talk, that was just the opposite. She is trying to imply this wisdom of unity, oneness, harmony in this empirical world of diversities, so that man can live a perfect life. So man can transform from selfishness to selflessness, from egoistic nature to the universal nature, from Jivatma to Paramatma, that I see myself in everything and I see everything in myself. This is not only a realization, Madam said, this realization can be executed, can be lived in this practical life. Thank you. But I enjoyed both the perspectives, the linguistic perspective, and the second one was the socio-human perspective or humanitarian perspective. I enjoyed both the talks. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Now, one sentence I would say to Professor Silvam, that as far as I remember, it was said by Bradley that the choice is not between metaphysics or no metaphysics. The choice is between good metaphysics and bad metaphysics. Waltz might have quoted him, but this is the saying, and this was Bradley's appearance and reality. In that context, Bradley said so. Thank you, sir.
Professor Das, and thanks for your observations. But as you say, analytic method is relevant, but to a point it is relevant, as you said, that we have a language where anirvachaniya comes, where indescribability comes, a new set of language works, as you say. So you talked of the language of self-realization. So there also, when you say language of self-realization, it's a different language, it's a different format. So there also maybe I don't know.
As you said,
there is a different language. So why do we avoid it? Why shouldn't we explore that area? What is that language of self-realization? So how far what Paneer Salam sir has done, how far that concept would be relevant, or is that this language of self-realization far exceeds the analytic trend that we have in Western philosophy? So we have the Western current in us, and we do have a language of self-realization where there is, as you said, there is nowhere and known becomes one, and there is a total silence. Silence is the strongest language. How do you define language? So silence speaks volumes, as you said. So at that stage, when you say the nowhere, everything becomes one, that's a different set of language. It's a different sort of language. So we do have a language of self-realization, and that is silence. So that's how well analytic philosophy can work there. So that's my understanding, taking both the position, all the positions together. So we do have, analytic philosophers may end up to the empirical world, but we can take that language, the linguistic trend further, and we can see the silence as the trend that can be explained through this analytic logical philosophy. Thank you very much. So it's
I shall respond to it, Dr. Rao.
Yes, carry on, sir.
Dr. Rao, I shall respond to it. If there is any necessity that I shall speak to you and you will listen to me, if there will be a speaker and there will be a listener, then only language is required.
Not necessarily, sir. Not necessarily. I talk to myself.
I am not saying.
I'm talking of the language of silence. I don't talk of the empirical knowledge, empirical language.
There is no language, sir. There is no language. I am.
The other. There is no requirement of the other. You speak inside.
I understood. I understood, sir. I am speaking something different. Please listen to me.
Carry on, sir. Carry on. Carry on.
When we are making linguistic analysis, when we understand language as language, we try to put all types of expressions, all types of sentences, which appear to be grammatical, into one laboratory. That is philosophical analysis. That is the problem. When I am speaking that metaphysical language, something different, that actually means that that type of pronouncement, that type of sentences, expressions, which are pronounced by the great men of the great seers, that cannot be adequately analyzed in this manner. William James, the famous book, The Varieties of Experiences, speaks that our experiences are different. So our experience of the empirical world is different from our experience of the higher entity in which the very person is concerned. It cannot be communicated to others. That I am saying, their language fails. It is not necessary to convince you about my realization, because my realization is my transformation. Whenever I need to explain to you through language, and I am using language, that is the relation between a teacher and student. Teacher knows what he knows, but when he is trying to communicate the truth to the student, the tool is language. Otherwise, he cannot teach. So their language is necessary. But for my realization, no language is necessary. Because language is our creation. Language is the creation of a society. So that analysis is good. But whenever we are discussing about metaphysical entities, that is a matter of realization, and we all have that realization. We are arguing because we are sitting on a chair and we are trying to defend a concept. No, we have to go beyond that. As a man, you ask to yourself, are you Dr. Rao? Are you really Dr. Rao? Are you really a professor? Yes, you are a professor and Dr. Rao by our necessities. Your parents have told you Dr. Rao, therefore you are Dr. Rao. But you are not Dr. Rao. If you are not a professor, you may be an engineer. So you are being a father, you are being a teacher, you are being everything. That is relatively true. But the ultimate truth, that I am Brahman, I am I, that is a matter of realization that we all have, but we don't speak. We speak academically, that we are trying to put everything into language. So that limits us. So we have to go beyond language. We have to go beyond grammar. We have to go beyond conventions, beyond society, beyond divisions, beyond diversities, even beyond dialectics. That is my point. And we are really that. My identity is that. Your identity is that. Tattamasi, you are Brahman. It is not a matter of a mere, very ordinary sentence. It appears to be grammatical. It is, yes, it is linguistic, but it is a matter of realization. A mother does not need any language to pacify the child. If the mother will touch the child remains silent. Only the touch of the mother is sufficient to make the child calm. Similarly, the touch of a great teacher, the very touch is sufficient to transform the wisdom from this mind to that mind. That is the parampara, Guru Shishya parampara. Their language is in, therefore neti neti. Therefore neti neti. That means not this, not this, not this, not this. Yes, it is an entertainment if we shall bring this type this phenomena into linguistic pattern, that's good. That is that academically that looks beautiful, but so far as realization is concerned, I think realization is realization, and we all have that, and that is our real identity. Madam told, let us don't have only the wisdom of Aditya, let us live with that. Let us build the society like that. Let us build the nation like that. This is the point. So, in the linguistic perspective, we can analyze everything, and therefore we can analyze Aditya. In this syllogism, this is very much a very good attempt. This is a human attempt. But so from the humanitarian standpoint, the madam spoke of humanitarian standpoint, that we should live with that wisdom, that we are all one. That is my submission.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Can I say something?
Sir, welcome, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Actually, there is some problem that I feel that I have not been properly understood by sir. What I was trying to say is that Indian philosophers, when they talk about the analysis, they use it in two different ways. Towards the end of my talk, I said, in Indian philosophical discourse, as it has been pointed out by many foreign thinkers like Howard and others, that in Indian philosophical tradition, language is used not only to convey the empirical truths, right? The same language, right? The same language is used in order to say something about the supersensuous reality. But that language also is a failure, no doubt. But that is the only way by which we can talk about Brahman. That is the reason why we have the Mahavakyas. So, without language, you cannot understand Brahman. I am not saying that the concept of Brahman has to be examined in a laboratory. No. I go beyond that. I say, even when you talk about, in the beginning also I pointed out, that there can be a relation between Brahman and language. But with regard to empirical, I gave the example of a table or chair, wherein the empirical objects can be seen and verified and checked, and we can say this is knowledge. But with regard to Brahman, should we dismiss that? No, we need not dismiss that. We use a different methodology. That's why, as Professor Rao has also pointed out, that neti-neti is used. And also I have used this method of adhyaropa and apavada, and also the lakshanas are used. So wherever you go, in order to say metaphysical truths also, you need language. Without language, you cannot understand anything. But that language which I am using, I mean which others have used, is a language which talks about the supersensuous reality. So that language cannot directly convey the knowledge of ultimate reality. It can point out, or it can show, that Brahman is something which can be known. That is the reason why in Mundaka it is said, once you know Brahman, you become Brahman. So the stage which you are talking about is to become Brahman. But in order to become Brahman, you must know Brahman. So these are the categories of language you are using. But that also I said, that category has a limitation, no doubt. But in order to say, I in fact quoted, remember, towards the end I quoted Professor K. Satchidanandamurthy, who said, in order to say something about Brahman, because we can't keep quiet, so some phrase or some terms are used. Their language ends. In fact, there is also another problem. There is an ontological leap which you are taking. I always use the word ontological leap. I have coined the word in order to talk about the leap that we take from the empirical to the transcendental. But that is very much essential, because we are talking about the metaphysical truths. Metaphysical truths can be explained by language, but not in this ordinary form. There, I think Professor has not properly paid attention to what I said. Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you. Sir, it is already 9 o'clock, sir. The debate will continue. We can
sir, speak only one sentence.
Okay, sir.
Language is our empirical necessity. That we agree. We have no problem with it. By language, I am a gentleman. By language, I am a teacher. By language, I am a father. So language, because of that empirical necessity, I have my empirical identity. We have no problem with that. But what I am speaking of, that is a matter of realization. And that is very much personal. Therefore, that realization is very much personal. So language means that what should be public, that should be only two persons. One is speaking, another person is listening. That is what is going to be there. But when that realization of the truth is personal, that is no duality to that truth, that truth. No duality, I am the speaker, I am the listener. And when these two are identified, then it's no duality. So, we are creating the truth. Which we are trying to assess for ourselves for our own identity through that force. That is the problem.
Thank you, Professor Dhan.
Can I have only one sentence?
Yes, sir.
See, once again the problem persists. See, I can explain this by giving an example which is available in Advaita Siddhi. It goes like this. Somebody is asking the question, which is the moon? Then the answer that is given is, the most resplendent is the moon. Now here, the term, the most resplendent is the moon, is not definition or description. Language is a pointer to Brahman. Please note that. Language is a pointer to Brahman. So we are not describing anything. No doubt language is used for the empirical purposes or in the phenomenal world, that I agree. But the same language we are using in order to say something about their language, becomes a failure. But in order to say something, we use that in the case of the most resplendent is the moon, it is not the description. Now, for example, the terms like Satyam Jnanam Anantam Brahma is used. Now, the word Satyam we cannot take the literal meaning of the word Satyam by saying that it refers to truth. In order to say that Brahman is different from Asatyam, the word Satyam is used. So, which means only by negative connotation you can understand and not a positive connotation. So, this means in a negative way you can understand Brahman through language. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Well, it was a great debate, and I do agree that what Professor Panneerselvam has pointed towards the last, we do agree it is indescribable, but still, in order to understand the notion, we need language. So before realizing the Brahman, we need a sort of language to describe the Brahman.
Right.
So neti-neti is the technique to approach Brahman. Well, we need language there. And what I could see is that even what Professor Das says, that I speak to myself, I understand, but that also, I see we can develop analytic trend there also, the language of silence. We can develop a very good thesis, the language of silence. So what you're talking about, both the sides can be brought in together and very nicely be taken as a very good area for research. And I see this linguistic trend can work, not only to this empirical standpoint that the Westerners see, we do can extend what I could learn from this lecture, that we do can extend by making a great ontological leap, as Professor Panneerselvam has said, that the matter of server, when you talk of self-realization, okay, so being one with the Brahman, we are making a great ontological leap. So even making that ontological leap, if at all there is a silence, that has a language. That is the language of silence, that is the language of self-realization. So this is what I could get from the discussion. Thank you, Professor Selvam, Professor Das, Professor B. Chandrika Madam, Professor Ranjit Ghosh sir. Thank you very much for making this evening so lively. I'm very much thankful to the speakers and all the question raisers. Thank you very much. Now over to Professor Kailas Chandra Mahana sir to carry on the further proceedings.
Okay, thanks so much, Professor Rao, for moderating the intersession. And today I enjoyed it, the talk of Professor Ponnirselvam, the way he discussed the logical linguistic analysis in order to communicate with the reality, to understand the reality, to understand Vedanta and Advaita and the fundamental problems of Indian philosophy. And today I can see a coherence and harmony between the talk of Professor Selvam and Professor Chandrika. And Professor Chandrika has taken that how we can establish the that is peace and universal brotherhood and harmony in this one. And I think that is if we have the linguistic clarity, if we have we can use the tool of logical linguistic analysis, then by using the tool of logical linguistic analysis, we can also establish harmony, universal brotherhood in the world. Okay, thanks so much. Now over to Professor Dr. over to Professor Pramod Kumar Das for the closure of the meeting.
So we thank everybody, both the speakers, Professor Ghosh, our Professor Chandrika, Professor Paneer Selvam, Professor Ranjit Ghosh, Professor Pramod.